ओम गणानां त्वा गणपतिं हवामहे कविं कवीनां उपमश्रवस्तमं ज्येष्ठराजं ब्रह्मणां ब्रह्मणस्पतां श्रुण्वन्नोतिभिः सीदसादनं श्रीमहागणाधिपतये नमः गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात्परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमाम् अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ॐ आप्यायन्तु ममाङ्गानि वाक्प्राणश्चक्षुश्रोत्रमथो बलमिन्द्रियाणि च सर्वाणि सर्वं ब्रह्मोपनिषदं माहं ब्रह्मनिराकुर्याम् मा ब्रह्मनिराकरोत् अनिराकरणमस्त्वनिराकरणं मेऽस्तु तदात्मनि निरते य उपनिषत्सु धर्मास्ते मयि सन्तु ते मयि सन्तु ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः. डियर् फ्रेण्ड्स्, वी आर् स्टिल् इन् दिस् इण्ट्रोडक्टरी भाष्यं बिकास् श्री शङ्कराचार्य वाण्ट्स् टु गिव् ए बर्ड्स् ऐ व्यू आफ् वाट् ईस् कर्म, वाट् ईस् उपासना, वाट् ईस् भक्ति एण्ड् वेर् आल् this going to lead, all these things, this karma and upasana, yoga, all this atma sanyama yoga and all these things, they do have their own limitation. So he is giving a bird's eye view of all these things before getting into the main subject of what is the self. So what is the self? That knowledge of the self is the basic theme of this Upanishad, as we said in the beginning. But we have to have a general understanding of what is the human activity, the whole range of human activity. Human activity means in the realm of dharma, not in the secular field, but in the spiritual field. In the spiritual field, he is also engaged in a lot of action. And in that field, what is the action which he is doing? And with what frame of mind he is doing an action? So he is doing an action with the frame of mind that he is a limited being, that he has to attain something. He has to attain something in order to strengthen himself or enlarge himself, and then by so enlarging he will be happy. So this is the frame of mind. So this is the mindset rather. So this is the value system. So having accepted a particular value system that by doing this I am going to get this. So this is going to give me happiness. So he is doing some karma. Karma means some sort of ritual. Now we are not talking about the secular karma of going to office, etc. We are talking about that which is the ethical conduct. The ethical conduct which gives him something called a positive merit, or if he does something bad, it gives a demerit. Is it okay?
Yes.
So that is, we are talking about that sort of karma. So that sort of karma, it is having its own limitation, because the karma, any action, karma means action, karma, any action or any ritual, it gives some result. And that result will depend on the volume of your karma, isn't it? Every action produces an equal and opposite reaction. So something like that, every karma produces proportionate amount of result. So if the karma is very great, if you perform a very great ritual, you get larger karma. You do some Ashwamedha or something like that, you are supposed to get the greatest phalam for that. So karma invariably gives some result, and you have to invariably enjoy that result. And in order to enjoy that result, again you have to take birth in this earth, because after all you have only a span of about 100 years. So in this 100 years you may not be able to exhaust that punya phala. So you will have to take birth repeatedly. So that is the limitation of karma. Then again, upasana. Upasana, what is upasana? Upasana is you visualize God form, some divine form, some saguna brahma as we called it. And then in this huge, infinite consciousness, a small portion of consciousness you are visualizing as that alambana, as that some sort of support, as that saguna brahma. And in that you are doing that upasana. And then by doing that upasana, what are you going to get? You are going to attain that particular state, isn't it? So karma is having a limitation, upasana is having a limitation, yoga, chitta, samadhi, etc. All those things, they are also having a limitation. So then what is the remedy? We read the last line. Last line we read was Tatra Komoha Kashyokaha Yekatvam Anupashyataha. So here, this is the line from Ishavasya Upanishad, which we have studied earlier. The mantra is Yasmin Sarvani Bhutani Atmaiva Bhut Vijanataha. Tatra Komoha Kashyokaha Yekatvam Anupashyataha. That was the mantra. That is, for one who sees unity. What is this? Yeah, Sarvani Bhutani Atmaiva Bhut Vijanataha. We are talking about a jnani, about a person who is a jnani. Where all the bhutani, that is all the beings, they become his own self. So for somebody who is seeing that sort of unity of his limited consciousness with that unlimited consciousness. So that is what we saw. Ekatvam anupashyataha. Ekatvam means unity. Unity of what? Unity of this limited consciousness with that unlimited consciousness, that infinite consciousness. So for that gentleman who is seeing that unity of this limited consciousness with that unlimited consciousness, where is the question of outsider or insider? Where is the question of my countryman, another countryman? Where is the question of Indian or Pakistani? So there is no question of all these things for such a jnani. So tatra ko moha, there is no delusion. Moha is delusion. That is delusion due to wrong cognition. Delusion only arises because of wrong understanding, wrong cognition. Then there, when there is no delusion, there is no shoka also, there is no grief. Tatra komoha kashyokaha, that is what we saw. Then we also read that line, tarati shokam atmavit. For that person who knows this atma, atmavit is one who knows that atman, he tarati shokam, he crosses that whatever is that ocean of sorrow. Well, not ocean, okay, you can call it an ocean of sorrow. So he crosses that thing. Then we have to read the next line. Let us read. Vidyate hrudaya granthihi chidyante sarva samshayaha kshiyante chasya karmani tasmin drushte paravare ityadi shrutibhyascha. So this is again a mantra from Mundaka Upanishad. This is said to be from 2-2-8, that is second adhyaya, second khanda and 8th mantra. So Mundaka Upanishad. So that Upanishad again is a fairly compact Upanishad, which again, this is one of the major Upanishads, one of the 10 major Upanishads, for which Shankaracharya has also written very detailed Bhashyam, and Anandagiri and others also have written commentaries. So from that Upanishad, this is the mantra. That is, Vidyate Hrudaya Granthihi. For the one who has seen this, you come to the last line of that mantra, Tasmin drushte paravare. Tasmin paravare drushte sati. Once that paravara is seen. Seen means realized, is understood. Once that paravara is understood by you. What is that paravara? Para is supreme. Para plus avara. All these things you have to break only. Para is supreme. Avara is inferior. Avara. You know the word vara. Vara is one who is selected and one who is supreme, isn't it? Avara is not a vara, one who is not selected, one who is rejected, that is inferior. That is apara brahma, that is one is para brahma and one is the apara brahma. But here we are not talking about para brahma and apara brahma, we are talking about para and avara. Avara is inferior, that is para means karanam, this avara means karyam. Para is that supreme brahman, karyam is what all is seen. What all here is seen in this universe is avara. What all is seen, it is a manifestation in that supreme Brahman. So all this thing is called avara. So that once one who realizes that, one who sees, the tasmin drushte means tasmin jnate. Paravare, tasmin paravare jnate. This is called sati saptami. We have come across this sati saptami earlier also. Once that is realized, then what happens? You come to the first line. Vidyate hrudaya granthihi. That thus Hrudaya Granthi gets cut. Destroyed. Bhidyate. Cut or destroy, cut the Gordian knot. So that is it. Hrudaya Granthihi. Hrudaya means Buddhi. In Vedanta, Hrudaya means Buddhi. Buddhi means intellect. In this intellect, there are so many knots. There are so many entanglements. There are so many things which have to be sorted out. So many bonds. All these bonds which a person has because of some wrong understanding. Because of some wrong understanding that, oh, so-and-so is going to save me, so-and-so I am dependent on so-and-so. so-and-so has to save me in my old age. So all these things, they are bonds. So so-and-so has to, I have to do this, say, in order to attain more power and then to attain more security. So these are all various knots which are there in the human mind. All these knots which are there in the human minds will be cut. Will be cut once you know that karyam, that karanam and karyam in a complete manner. That karyam which is complete, and then purnam adah purnam idam. Once you know that, asmin drushte paravare, once you know that, that whatever is there is here. Para and avara, what you call avara also is not totally avara. Because again in another mantra we are saying purnam adah purnam idam purnat purnam udachyate. So this human being, what we call the limited consciousness, is nothing but that supreme consciousness only. So that purnamada purnamidam level also we are seeing. So once you see that, all the hrudaya granthis, the knots of the intellect gets they get destroyed. Then vidyate hrudaya granthi chidyante sarva samshayaha. Samshaya is doubts, all types of doubts. Samshayaha samyak shete iti samshayaha. All these things, they are so well entrenched in the heart or in the buddhi. Samshaya is something which is so entrenched in the heart. Samshaya, sam plus shete, samyak shete iti samshaya. That is that which is, say, ingrained, or that which is so strongly entrenched, or it has taken roots in your mind or intellect, is called the samshaya. So all those things, they chidyante, they just get dispelled. Then chiyante cha asya karmani. Chiyante cha means and. Asya karmani, of this person, all the karmas, asya karmani, all the karmas of this person, kshiyante, they get destroyed. Because all the karma has relevance so long as you have a limited perspective. So long as you feel that you are a limited person, so long as you feel that you are going from this place to another loka, then karma has a relevance. You are working in a totally different framework. You are working in the framework of samsara. In this framework of samsara, you think that you are a limited being. By doing some yajna, you are going to go to some devaloka, or you have to say you will go and some dance with some Ramba and Urvasi and all those people. So this is the limited framework in which man functions, isn't it? Or he will do some other thing, and then he will get some punyam, and then he will be born as some king or something like that. Or he will get some riches in this same life. So these are all the things. So, you are functioning in a limited framework, in a limited framework of samsara. Once you shake off from this limited framework, once you get out of this framework, then what is remaining? You are one with that Supreme Brahman. Once you are one with that infinite, then where is the question of going? So, if somebody asks you, what is the center for the infinite? Where is the center? You yourself are the center, I am myself am the center. So, everybody is the center for this, infinity. Infinity means all around. There is no end. So that is what is the meaning of Digambara also. Digambara is something which is sarvavyapi. Once that is sarvavyapi, it cannot be clothed in something. Only when something is limited, it can be clothed. When something is unlimited, it cannot be clothed. So as long it is there, so that is why Shiva is called Digambara. So that is why, that is the meaning of Digambara for Lord Shiva. So anyway, so asya karmani shiyante. So all these karmas, they produce the karma and the meaning, the result of that karma, they make some sense in a limited framework. But once you are identifying yourself with that infinite, then where is the question of going from one place A to place B? Place A, place B, place C, everything is in that infinitude only. So there is no question of any karma phala also. So all the karmas will get destroyed. So that is the meaning. The karmas will lose their relevance. The karma will lose their relevance. They lose their the very existence. So that is the meaning here. Asya karmani tasmin drushte paravare ityadi shruti bhyasya. Like this, several other shrutis are also there. So here, there is a doubt. For whom? For this Mimamsaka. We know that there is a school of philosophy called Mimamsakas. Mimamsakas, they are strict ritualists. Of course, they have their own place in the whole system, because the first portion of the Veda actually is dealing with lot many rituals, isn't it? But then Vedanta, the final word of Veda, says you have to grow from this level and then come to the other level. So that is what Vedanta says. So when you take a text, you have to go up to the, you should not stop with the beginning only. You have to go till the last word. So the last word is the final word, isn't it? The last word is the message. So, but then these people are more content, more happy with this ritual because there is a sense of achievement there. Because some people, say half a dozen people, very loudly reciting some Veda mantras, and then say all this Ghana, Jata and all those process, and then they display their knowledge. So there are so many things which are put into the fire. There is a lot of activity. There is a great sense of achievement. There is a great sense of showing off one's knowledge. So all these things, there is a yajna is an opportunity for so many things. Because this man, he shows off his knowledge. No, you have to put this here, and then he will quote a mantra. Then some other man will say, no, it has to be this way. He will quote another mantra. So all these rituals will contain so many procedural details. So the more procedural details you know, like your say office administration, if you know all these rules and all these sub rules, like your income tax man, then you are a most competent man. But when you are not in that framework at all, it doesn't matter at all. Even if you know 1,000 rules, it does not matter at all. So there is a mimamsaka who knows all these rules. Like in your office, you may find somebody who knows the whole rule book by heart. So this mimamsaka is somebody who is like that rule book man, who doesn't want to get out of that mimamsa mindset. He only wants that. He feels that, okay, I do this thing, I do this yajna, I jolly well get this result. So I need not bother for any other thing. I need not bother for your Vedanta. I need not bother for Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, etc., etc. So that is his frame of mind. So he says, okay, you are admitting that you are talking about something called Paravara, admitting that you are talking about something called Moksha, admitting that you are talking about something called Supreme Bliss and whatnot. Okay, is it not attainable by a combination of Karma and Upasana? So that is what he says. So karma is there. Okay, along with this karma, I will also do some upasana. I will also do some upasana of some karmanga, avabaddha upasana. Such things are also there. So along with this karma, associated with this karma, some upasana also is there. Where you visualize some deity, some saguna brahma, saguna form, and then on that saguna form, you do some meditation. So that is that saguna upasana. So let us do that. Will you not get it? So the point is, he doesn't want to leave this karma at all. So that is the point. So the question is, so let us read. Karma sahita adapi jnanat.
Karma sahita adapi jnanat.
Yetat siddhyati iti chet.
Yetat siddhyati iti chet.
Na. So the purva paksha is, karma sahita adapi jnanat. Yetat siddhyati. Then siddhanti says, na. No. So the Purvapasha, in this Purvapasha, we have to see this word jnanam. Karma sahita adapi jnanat. Karma sahita means along with this karma. Jnanat yetat siddhyati means this is attainable. Jnanam here, I told you in the last class also, jnanam is used in two different meanings. Depending on the context, we have to see the meaning. Jnanam is used for Supreme Brahma Jnanam. And jnanam or vidya, the word jnanam or vidya, they are also used for upasana. We have seen this in Ishavasya Upanishad in the beginning. Vidyam cha yas tadvedo ubhayagam saha. That mantra we have seen. Vidyam cha yaha tadveda ubhayagam saha. We have seen that. So there, what is it that is told there? Karma upasana samuchaya. Samuchaya means a combination. So karma, there you call it karma vidya, combination. Vidya also, like this jnanam, vidya gives two meanings. Vidya is that Brahma vidya, that supreme knowledge of Brahman, or vidya is that limited saguna Brahma jnanam, and depending on the context you have to take it. So here in this context, karma sahita adapi jnanat means, from the reply which Shankaracharya is going to give, we have to take the meaning of upasana and not brahmajnanam. Karma sahita adapi jnana adetat siddhyati iti chet. Of course, they also say karma sahita, they also say you do karma simultaneously, you also do shravana manana nididhyasanam, that also they say. But in this particular context, depending on the reply, if we see the reply which Shankaracharya is going to give, the meaning is upasana. In fact, karma sahita adapi jnana, they also say not only upasana, They also say, Shravana Manana Nididhyasana also you will keep doing, and then you also do karma. So that is what they say. But here in this context, it is different. Okay, let us see the reply. Na. Vajasaneyake.
Vajasaneyake.
Tasya anyakaranatva vachanat.
Tasya anyakaranatva vachanat.
Jaya mesyat.
Jaya mesyat.
Iti prastutya.
Iti prastutya.
Putrena ayam loko jayaha.
Putrena ayam loko jayaha.
Nanyena karmana.
Nanyena karmana.
Karmana pitruloko.
Karmana pitruloko.
Vidyaya devalokaha.
Vidyaya devalokaha.
Iti.
Iti.
Atmana anyasya lokatrayasya.
Atmana anyasya lokatrayasya.
Karanatva muktam vajasaneyake.
Karanatva muktam vajasaneyake.
So here the Siddhanti or the Vedanti. The earlier question was put by Mimamsaka. Now the Vedanti is replying. He is refuting the argument of that Mimamsaka. He says, no, no. You are talking about this combo, combination of karma and upasana. Karma and upasana, they give totally different result. If you see various shrutis, they show that these two things, they are meant for totally different results. And he is quoting certain things. Vajasaneyake, Vajasaneya means Vajasaneyaka is Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. That is the another name for Brihadaranyaka Upanishad is Vajasaneyaka Brahmana. So from that, Tasya means of this karma and also combination of upasana, Anya Karanatva Vachanat. So these two things are Karanam for something else. These two things are Karanam. Karanatva Vachanat means it is mentioned that these two things cause something else. That is the meaning. Then Jaya Mesyat. So it is again then Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. This is from this Brahmavidya Brahmanam, this first Adhyaya. Fourth Brahmana, that is called Brahmavidya Brahmanam, 18th, 17th mantra, it says, Jaya Mesyat. There, the person, he is, the person who is not a jnani. We are not talking about a jnani, we are talking about a karmata, a person who wants to achieve all these, say, karma phalas in this world. He says, Jaya Mesyat, let me have a wife. Jaya Mesyat means, let me have a wife. Iti prastutya. So, having started like that, putrena ayam lokaha jayaha na anyena karmana. So, I think in one of these last classes, we talked about the eshanatrayam. Eshanatrayam means this putreshana, vitteshana and lokeshana. That is, putreshana is, that is the desire to have children. Children means putra, male children. That is because this man is going to continue this lineage called Swadhyaya. So Swadhyaya is, if you are Rigvedi, you are supposed to do Rigveda. So your son also will do Rigveda, study Rigveda, his son will study Rigveda. So this lineage is preserved. So by preserving this, ayam lokaha jayaha means this world is conquered, means not as though you are going and conquering this thing, you are say keeping up your lineage, number one, you are preserving that Veda, your Vedic tradition. So that in that sense, ayam lokaha jayaha, and he will continue to do yajnas and all these things. He will continue to do various activities for the welfare of the society. So that is the meaning here. Yajna is basically, it is for loka sangraha also. Yajna, if it is done as a kamya karma, it is for himself. Yajna, if it is done as a nishkama karma, it is for loka sangraha, it is for social welfare. So he will do all these things. He will continue to do all these things, means that is, you are making your presence felt in the society. So that is ayam lokaha jayaha. This loka is conquerable. This loka is conquered by having putra. Then na anyena karmana, not by any other means. Then karmana pitrulokaha. Pitruloka, you know, by performing all these things, you go to that pitruloka. This also we have seen earlier. Then vidyaya devalokaha. Vidya here means upasana, not brahma vidya. Vidyaya devalokaha. By doing that upasana of a saguna brahma or a god form, which you have visualized. So you will achieve a particular loka. You will achieve a particular a sort of experiential state, which is called loka. Loka, it is not somewhere, not a three-dimensional place which is there somewhere in the sky or space. It is an experiential state. Shankaracharya repeatedly tells that. It is not something which is some loka which is there somewhere in the space. It is your own experiential state. Lokyate iti lokaha. Lokyante drushyante. That is the meaning. Lokyate means that which is experienced. That which is experienced is a loka. Janmani also another meaning he writes is lokyate iti lokaha janmani. Janma also is a loka. So in this janma, in this loka, you are born as something else, some other life. So that is also a loka. So its own loka. If somebody is born as a pig or something like that is his loka. So loka does not mean, does not refer to some other place. Here Pitruloka is a slightly better thing, not a lower form. So Pitruloka is something better once you do various good deeds in this life, but where you have done for your own benefit. You go to some Pitruloka and then again come back. So that is the meaning here. Then Vidyaya Devaloka. Once you do this Vidya Upasana also, then you go to a Devaloka. So this is again from the same Brihadaranyaka Upanishad. Then iti atmana anyasya lokatrayasya karanatva muktam vajasaneke. In that vajasaneka, that is in that Brihadaranyaka Upanishad, atmana anyasya lokatrayasya. So this lokatrayam, that what is this manushya loka, pitruloka and devaloka, these three lokas, these three experiential states are something different from atma. Atmana anyasya lokatrayasya. These three lokas are something different from atmana anyasya. That is something different from that atman. The karanatva muktam. So this what you talk about karma and vidya combination is karanam for this lokatrayam, not for moksha. So that is what he says. Then tatraivacha parivrajya vidhane heturuktaha. किं प्रजया करिष्यामो येषां नोऽयमात्मा अयं लोकः इति. ओके, सो देन अगेन ही गिव्स वन मोर रीजन. सो इफ यू फील दट दिस कर्म एंड उपासना आर द ओनली द होल द सम एंड सब्सटेंस ऑफ लाइफ, then why do Vedas talk about what is called sannyasa? Vedas, they are also extolling the supremacy of that sannyasa. They are talking about the greatness of that sannyasa ashrama. If you feel that this karma and upasana are the be all and end all of the whole life, human life, why is Veda prescribing sannyasa is a higher ashrama? So if this thing, if karma and upasana are only adequate, they are the only things to be bothered by a human being, then why is Shruti talking about a sannyasa? So that is the meaning here. Tatraivacha means there itself, tatra evacha, there itself, parivrajya vidhane heturuktaha. Parivrajya vidhana, parivrajya is parivrajaka. Who is parivrajaka? Paritaha vrajati iti parivrajakaha. One who does not stay in a particular place but moves all around. not some medical representative or anything. So parivrajya, once he has given up everything, one who has given up everything, and then one who moves around and who makes a living by totally begging, bhikshacharyam. One who makes a living by bhikshacharyam, that is what is the sannyasa. We have seen it in Gita Bhashyam, in the very beginning, first chapter of Gita, Arjuna wants to take up sannyasa. Bhakshyam api loke. Bhakshyam, bhikshacharyam is better, that is what that man says. So he has to do some bhikshacharyam, survive by bhikshacharyam. He is not supposed to dwell in a particular place for a long time. Suppose somebody is giving good bhiksha, you should not settle down there. He should keep on moving, and then he should keep on teaching some good things to the people. The purpose of Parivrajaka is, he will be moving around. He is a sort of role model for various people. He is a sort of role model to show that a man can renounce these things. Renounce, not for showing some spiritual pride. Not for demonstrating spiritual pride that he is renouncing, but to explain the fact that there is something higher. You are doing some work and then you are getting some result. So, but the Vedanta says, you will get a much, much higher thing called moksha. You have a greater thing called bliss. And then this sannyasi is a symbol of bliss also. This sannyasi is so happy. This sannyasi is a symbol of bliss. So he is a walking, say, personification of bliss. So that sort of, he is seen by all the people, and then he is a sort of role model for the people. So sannyasa is renouncing this in order to get a higher bliss. By doing some karma, you will get some result. With that, you will feel some happy, you will feel some happiness. But once you lose it, suppose you do some karma and you achieve something, and suppose that is lost. Once that is lost, there is more agony. You have got it and then you lost it, and there is more agony because of that. So this karma is having its own limitation. So this sannyasi is a greater chap who renounces all these things, and then he settles down for a higher bliss. So that is the purpose of sannyasa. So let us see this. Parivrajya vidhane. Parivrajakasya bhavaha parivrajyam. So the state of being a sannyasi is parivrajyam. Parivrajaka is sannyasi. Parivrajyam is the state of being a sannyasi. Parivrajya vidhanam. Vidhanam means vidhi. Vidhi is, what is vidhi? Prescription. Vidhanam, parivrajya vidhanam. Prescription or procedure. Let us say both meanings are there. The prescription or an injunction or a procedure. In that parivrajya vidhane, hetu ruktaha, hetu the karanam, the reason is told. The reason for that parivrajya. Kim prajaya karishyamo yesham noyam atma ayam lokaha. So he says, he is in a different frame of mind. Kim prajaya karishyamaha. What shall we do with the children? What shall we do with these children? Yesham naha. We for whom? Ayam atma ayam lokaha. This atma is our own loka. This atma, which is nothing other than Brahman, it is our loka. Esham naha. Naha means for us. Esham naha. Naha means for us. That is Shashti Bahuvachanam. For us. Ayam atma ayam lokaha. This atma itself is the loka for us. Atma is something which is, we are experiencing. We are Brahmanishtas. We are in this state. For us who have realized say this paravara, and who know this supreme, who have realized the unity of this limited consciousness with that supreme consciousness, then for us, what is the, will it make any sense when you talk about praja, then pitruloka, devaloka, etc., etc.? So for this prajaya karishyamaha, this word praja is also an upalashanam for other things also. In the earlier line we saw, putra, anyena karmana, karmana pitrulokaha, vidyaya devalokaha. So then when you say this praja is also, what is this? Tatraivacha, karma, upasana, okay. So this praja is an upalashanam for three things. That is praja, karma and upasana. For all the three things, it is upalashana. Upalashana means it is indicative. When you know, when you tell one word, it also covers all other words in the same group. Karma, praja, upalashana, this upasana, all these fall into one category. So in that particular category, when you mention one word, all other words are taken care of. So this hetvartha, tatra ayam hetvartha.
Tatra ayam hetvartha.
So here hetvartha means the purpose, the full meaning is like this. Praja, karma.
Praja karma. Tat sanyukta vidyabhihi.
Manushya pitru deva loka traya sadhanaihi. Anatma loka pratipatti karanaihi. Kim karishyamaha. Nacha asmakam. Lokatrayam anityam. Sadhana sadhyam ishtam. Yesham asmakam. Swabhavikaha. Ajaha ajaraha amrutaha abhayaha. Na vardhate karmana nokaniyan. Nityascha lokaha ishtaha. Okay. So here, tatra ayam hetvarthaha. that hetu, the reason told for parivrajya or sannyasa, the hetu is, that is the main, what is the full implication is, though the only one word is mentioned there, praja, all the three are included. That is what Shankaracharya also is explaining. What is that? Hetvarthaha, the meaning of that hetu, the full meaning of that hetu is like this. Hetu means cause, the reason given. The meaning is like this, praja, karma, tat sanyukta vidyabhihi. Praja, having children, karma, doing various rituals, tat samyukta vidyabhihi. Tat samyukta means karmana samyukta vidya. That is karma associated with that upasana. So karma upasana combination. So he is referring to three things here. Praja is one, karma is one, karma plus upasana is one. So by these things, what is it you are going to get? Manushya, Pitru, Devaloka, Traya, Sadhanaihi. So these three things are getting three things respectively. What are those things getting respectively? Manushya Loka, Pitru Loka and Devaloka are attained respectively by these three combinations. Then, and what is the status of these things? Anatma Loka Pratipatti Karanaihi. All these things are Anatma. Anatma, that is one word, they are all categorized as Anatma. You say this Manushya Loka, it is Anatma. You say Pitru Loka, it is Anatma. You say Deva Loka, it is Anatma. That is not the real nature of Brahman. The Brahman is totally infinite. Whereas you are talking about some finite lokas. You are talking about some small globules here and there, leaving the whole ocean. Leaving the whole ocean, you are talking about some small globules of water. You are saying that, oh, this is the loka, this is the loka, this is the loka. This is karmana, pitru loka. This is one small globule or some small module, let us say. And pitru loka is a small module. Deva loka is another module. You are leaving that infinitude and then you are confining yourself to these small things. So these are all anatma. This is not the real atma. This is not the real Brahma. So that is the meaning. So, what is this? Anatma loka pratipatti karanaihi. Pratipatti means attainment. Anatma loka pratipatti karanaihi. These are the karanam for attaining this anatma lokas. That is, lokas which are something something different from atman. So, that is the meaning. Then, pratipatti karanaihi kim karishyamaha. What shall we do? What do we have to do? What shall we do? What have we to do with them? We have nothing to do with them. So that is the meaning. What have we to do with them? Nacha asmakam lokatrayam anityam ishtam. This lokatrayam, asmakam means for us, anityam lokatrayam sadhya sadhanam ishtam. Sadhana sadhyam ishtam. This sadhana sadhyam. Sadhana is means. Sadhana is means. Sadhyam is that you achieve by means is that sadhyam. Sadha dhatu, sadhanam is a tool or a strategy or an equipment, whatever you say. Sadhana is a tool. Sadhyam is something which you are achieving by that tool. Sadhyam. So, all these lokas which you talked about, that is Manushya Loka, Pitru Loka and Deva Loka are sadhana sadhyas. That is, you are having putra. Putra is a sadhanam. Then in another thing, karma is the sadhanam. In another thing, karma plus upasana, that is the sadhanam. So, these three sadhanani, or these three tools, or instruments, or implements, or strategies, they are producing a result. Three different results, of course. So, those three different results are sadhana sadhyas. And what does it hint? It only hints that all these sadhana sadhyas, they have a limited tenure. They have their own limitation. They are not permanent. They are not eternal. They are not nitya. Nitya is something, that word also we are getting, the next line is showing that word also. So, all these things are highly limited in nature. They have got their own time, duration or whatever it is what is that time called? Expiry date. So, they do have an expiry date and then you have to again come back to square one. So, sadhana sadhyam nacha asmakam ishtam, we do not like. Esham asmakam, for whom? Esham asmakam is that very confident tone. We have nothing to do with all these things. This gentleman who is a jnani, he is saying in a very confident tone, we who know this this loka, what have we to do with all these things? They are of no use, they are of little use to us. So, in that tone he is saying, Esham asmakam for us, this swabhavikaha. Swabhavika means natural. Naturally, you get into that stage. Once you realize that supreme thing, you are naturally elevated. Your ego is gone. Your ego has merged with the universal ego. You are not ego, universal consciousness, where that I, notion of I itself is not there. So you are, when you are in that ocean itself, swabhavikaha, ajaha, ajaraha, amrutaha. Ajaha, ajaha means birthless. This consciousness which is birthless. So you cannot talk about consciousness was born at a particular time. So if you say that consciousness was born at a particular time, then who is the witness to that? If suppose presume there is a witness to that, then that is that consciousness, isn't it? When you are witnessing something, you are intelligent. And that intelligence only we are talking about. So intelligence or consciousness is something which is not produced, it is aja. That is something which is originless. It is always, it is there. So you cannot say, it was, suppose there is a pen. The pen was not there, say, about 10 years ago. It will not be there. If I want to break it, I can break it right now. So it will not be there in the very next moment. So this has pragabhava. This has prior non-existence. And once it goes, say, what is this called? Pragabhava, pradvamsabhava. That is, once I break it, then again it will, this abhava or say non-existence will be there. So this thing had a non-existence earlier and then this will have a non-existence later. Prak, abhava, pradvamsa, abhava. There are four types of abhavas, we need not go into that. So, but then in the case of knowledge or in the case of consciousness, if somebody says, it was born at that particular time, so then there is a witness to that. So that is that, that is intelligence, isn't it? So then pradvamsa abhava, for that pradvamsa again there is a need for a witness, somebody who has to see, somebody who has to know it. So for this is something which is unborn, eternal, it will never die. Ajaraha, it doesn't have old age. Jara is old age, geriatric, jara. Undecaying, it has no change. Then amrutaha, it is deathless. Amrutaha, that is, it is deathless. Abhayaha, so when you are in that frame of mind, there is no question of bhaya. Bhaya is fear. So fearlessness is something which is told in Vedanta. One who is a jnani or one who is a wise man, he will have no fear. So abhayam vindati, that is, he attains abhayam. What is the meaning of abhayam? Dvitiya dvai bhayam. There is a saying in, there is another saying, Shruti which says, Dvitiya dvai bhayam. Only when you see yourself as an enemy to somebody else, or when you see somebody else as an enemy to you, or somebody who is other than you, leave alone enemy or friend, somebody other than you, then you have your own, you draw your lines, you draw your barriers, and then there is a safe distance and whatnot. When you don't see somebody as other than you, when you see every not only human being, the whole universe which is part of you, then there is no question of being an outsider. Then there is no question of any bhaya from anybody. You have no fear from anybody. You are open to anybody. You don't draw your lines. You don't draw your personal boundaries and you don't draw any lines. So that is the meaning of abhaya. So where the person has no fear at all of anything. So abhayaha, navardhate karmana nokaniyan. So this jnanam is something, this moksha is something, navardhate karmana nokaniyan. So karmana vardhate, what does karmana vardhate? Punyam vardhate karmana. You do a small yajna, you get this punyam. You do a bigger yajna, you do bigger punyam. Or you do some upasana, you get some big loka. You do upasana of some other higher deity, you go to some other thing. So these are all things which grow, or which are proportionate to the karma. All these lokas or results, they are proportionate to the karma you do. So whereas moksha is something which is infinite, it cannot grow further. Na karmana vardhate no kaniyan, it doesn't go down also. Infinite cannot be reduced in size also. Infinite cannot grow bigger, it cannot be reduced in size. So moksha is something which is your own nature. Your own, that infinite nature, it does not grow, and then it has no relevance to karma. Karma is relevant in a smaller framework, in the framework of samsara, in the context of samsara or in the frame of reference of samsara, but not in the context of jnana. So here, na karmana vardhate no kaniyan. This jnanam is something, it does not grow by karma, it does not decline by karma. No kaniyan. Nityasya lokaha ishtaha. We want that particular loka. We are in that loka, we want that particular loka. And we have nothing to do with your all this praja, karma, upasana, etc., etc. We don't want it. So that is the meaning. Is it clear?
Yes, sir.
Sacha nityatvat.
Na
avidya nivrutti vyatirekena. Anya sadhana nishpadyaha. Tasmat. Pratyagatma brahma vijnana purvakaha. Sarvaishana sanyasa eva kartavya iti. So, okay. Sacha. That sa means that. What is that? In the earlier line, we talked about moksha. That lokaha, ayam atma, ayam lokaha, that atma loka, or that jnana. The atma loka, we should not again confuse it to some loka. When you hear the word loka, you immediately visualize some sort of three-dimensional thing. So, atma loka again, we should not think that it is another loka. Here, when you say atma loka, it is only a metaphorical usage. Because earlier you have referred to various other lokas, pitru loka, deva loka, matu manushya loka, etc., etc. No, we don't want all those lokas, we are in our own Atmaloka. So, it is a metaphorical usage, not referring to a particular, say, place. So, when Sacha, you are referring to that state, let us say, that state of awareness, that state of understanding of the unity of consciousness, Sacha, Nityatvat, because that thing is something which is eternal, that which does not change at all. So, why, as it is so, then, na avidya nivrutti vyatirekena anya sadhana nishpadyaha. Except by eradicating your avidya, it is not attainable by any sadhana. Karma is a sadhanam, praja is a sadhanam, upasana is a sadhanam. By those things, it is not attainable. It is attainable only by cleaning your mind. It is attainable only by removing the avidya. So, avidya is actually responsible for your karma, upasana, etc. This avidya has made you think that you are a finite being. Avidya has made you think that, say, you have to do this particular yajna to get this result. Avidya has made you think that you have to do this upasana of a saguna brahma. So, when you do this upasana of a saguna brahma also, you are in a state of avidya only. So, you have to come out of that avidya. You have to get rid of that avidya. Avidya nivrutti vyatirekena. Vyatirekana means apart from. Apart from avidya nivrutti. Avidya nivrutti means apart from this eradication of avidya, eradication of ignorance. Apart from eradication of ignorance. Na anya sadhana nishpadyaha. It is not attainable. Nishpadya means, we know that nishpatti. Nishpatti rasa nishpatti. Nishpadana means extracting. It cannot be extracted or it cannot be achieved. Extracted is not the right word. It is not achieved, it is not attained, or it is not achievable or attainable. You can write like that. Na anya sadhana nishpadyaha. This is not achievable or attainable by any other sadhana apart from eradicating your ignorance. So, first of all, you have got a particular frame of mind. In that frame of mind, you have been doing karma, your upasana, etc., etc. That frame of mind, you please keep it away. That is what it says. That particular frame of mind, you please creep it away or you destroy that frame of mind and that then know about yourself. So, that is what is the meaning here. Then, tasmat, pratyagatma brahma vijnana purvakaha, sarvaishana sanyasa eva kartavya iti. So, tasmat, therefore, pratyagatma brahma vijnana purvakaha. So, this statement you please see. Pratyagatma. Pratyagatma means that indwelling Atman. Atma means consciousness. That indwelling consciousness. Pratyagatma Brahma. This indwelling consciousness itself is Brahma. So, the unity of that Pratyagatma and Brahman. That is the meaning here. That unity of consciousness of this indwelling consciousness and unity of this indwelling consciousness with this infinite consciousness. That is Pratyagatma Brahma Vijnana. Vijnana means realization, not only say theoretical knowledge, but it is realization. But Brahma Vijnana Purvakaha, or here in this particular context, we can also say knowledge, not exactly realization. Then with that,
Yeah, realization also we can say here, because sarvaishana sannyasa eva kartavya iti. So sarvaishana sannyasa eva kartavya. So this sannyasa are renouncing all these yeshana trayam, all this yeshana, the loka yeshana, putreshana, vitteshana, etc., etc., all those things have to be renounced. Idi kartavya iti. So that is, after realizing the unity, vijnana purvakaha, that word also you please see. Vijnana purvakaha. Vijnana purvakaha means this vijnanam should be there already. That is, after realizing that vijnanam, then you automatically do this sannyasa. Because once you realize that your greater self, you will not be bothered about a smaller self, isn't it? Once you realize that you are a much bigger self, you are not bothered about your smaller self. Suppose you are promoted as a manager, you will not go and sit in the seat of a typist. So it is like that. So once you realize your bigger role, you are not again going to go back to your smaller role. So that is the meaning here. Then is it okay?
Yes.
Sarva yeshana sannyasa eva kartavya iti. Next. Karma sahabhavitva virodhacha.
Karma sahabhavitva virodhacha.
Pratyagatma brahma vijnanasya.
Pratyagatma brahma vijnanasya.
So here, he is using, Shankaracharya is using the word vijnanam to refer to Brahma Vijnanam, and he is specifically mentioning it also. So he is not leaving any doubt. So here he says, karma sahabhavitva virodhacha pratyagatma brahma vijnanasya. This pratyagatma, what? The same indwelling self. Pratyagatma brahma vijnanam. That is, unity of this pratyagatma and Brahman is something karma sahabhavitva virodhi. That is, it is totally antagonistic to the karma. It cannot coexist with karma. Karma sahabhavitvam. Sahabhavitvam means to stay together. Saha is together. Bhavitvam is to be. Sahabhavitvam. Bhu dhatu. Bhu means to be, isn't it? Bhu. Bhavitvam. Sahabhavitvam. Just to be together. A simultaneous existence, let us say. A coexistence, simultaneous existence. So that is it. Karma sahabhavitva virodhacha. So this vijnana, pratyagatma brahma vijnanam, is something which is antithetical to this karma. So it cannot coexist. So that is the meaning here. Why? We just discussed all the while. Because once you know this unity of this consciousness with the supreme thing, you are on a bigger frame of reference. Why do you bother about this small frame of reference? So this karma becomes irrelevant. In this karma, there is a notion of I. This limited ego, this limited consciousness, it has developed a notion called I. So that notion of I want to achieve this, I have to do this, I, it is there. Whereas when you have rejected that I, and when you have merged with that great ocean of consciousness, then there is no I there. There is no achiever, there is no achievable, there is no sadhyam, there is no sadhanam, there is no sadhyam, there is nothing there. So in such a state, then that is something which is antithetical to karma. So the Mimamsaka says, okay, you keep doing karma, you also read Vedanta. It is not possible. One is having a strong notion of I, the other is strongly rejecting that I. Is it clear? Oh, karma is something which is strongly having that notion of I, whereas the jnanam is a stage where you have totally rejected that notion of I. So how can they coexist? How can they live together? So karma sahabhavitva virodhacha pratyagatma brahma vijnanasya. Nahi upatta karaka phalabheda vijnanena karmana.
Upatta karaka phalabheda vijnanena karmana.
Pratyastamita sarvabheda darshanasya.
Pratyastamita sarvabheda darshanasya.
Pratyagatma brahma vishayasya. सहभावित्वम् उपपद्यते वस्तु प्राधान्ये सति अपुरुषतन्त्रत्वात् ब्रह्मविज्ञानस्य. सो हियर अगेन दिस सम वर्ड्स आर इम्पोर्टेंट. देन हियर यू सी नहि उपात्त कारक फल भेद विज्ञानेन कर्मण. सो दिस कर्म इज समथिंग विच इज एक्सेप्टिंग or which is taking into consideration, or it is accepting, let us say, accepting a particular value system, where upatta, meaning of upatta, I am saying, upatta means svikruta, having accepted, that which is accepted, upatta, Karaka phala bheda vijnanena. So you are accepting a bheda, difference or a distinction between karakam, phalam, bhedam. Karakam, kartrukaraka, karanakaraka, karmakaraka, I am doing this. Kartrukaraka, I am karanakaraka, by this I am doing. Karakam? No, kartrukaraka, karmakaraka, karanakaraka, upadanakarakam, sampradane chaturthi. In grammar you see this karma. Okay, we need not go into that. Karaka basically is the relationship between the actor and the action. Is in different ways. The relationship between a person who performs an act and the action, it is in different ways. I hit with a pen. So this pen becomes a karana karakam. I am the karta and this is the karanam. That karma is hitting, is a karma. So we can go into grammar to explain this thing. So by me this is something is hit. So this sort of karta karanam, karana karma karma, so this karakam, so that feeling of that notion of I am doing something by this yajna is a karma, then by this karma I am achieving that thing, and sampradane chaturthi, that is another karakam, that is I am performing puja, I am performing worship of a particular deity. So for that particular deity, that is he, that deity becomes the object for that sampradana karakam. So like that. So anyway, that karakam. Then phalam. Phalam is result. So there is a distinction of who is the karta, what is the karma, what is the action, then what is the phalam. All this, there is so much of bheda jnanam. So in atma jnanam, there is no bheda jnanam. So here in karma, there is a distinction. Oh, I am different. This action is different. I am doing this for this particular phalam. That phalam is different. And a particular deity whom I am propitiating, that particular deity is different. So there is so much of distinction here in this karma. Whereas in atma, there is no such distinction. So you have accepted a lot of the sense of distinction. You have accepted this distinction or difference among so many things, and then you are doing engaged in karma, upasana and all these things. Whereas in atma jnanam, there is no such difference. So that is the meaning here. Pratyagatma brahma, where is this? Upatta karaka phala bheda vijnanena karmana. With this karma, which has accepted this difference of this karakam, phalam, etc., then pratyastamita sarvabheda darshanasya atma vijnanasya. So this atma vishayam, atma vijnanam, then what is this? Pratyastamita sarvabheda darshanam. So all this vision, bheda darshanam is seeing difference. Bheda darshanam, darshanam means seeing, that vision. Bheda darshanam means that vision of duality. Bheda darshanam is vision of duality. Pratyastamita bheda darshanam means that vision of duality is, say it has ceased to exist, it has stopped to exist. Is it difficult?
No.
CEASED, ceased. It has ceased to exist, it has stopped to exist. So that is the meaning. So this vision of duality has stopped to exist, which means he is not seeing any difference in anything. Who? The jnani. So for this person who is a jnani, who has this pratyastamita sarvabheda darshanam. So this bheda darshanam or this vision of duality is pratyastamitam. That is, it is gone. It has disappeared. Disappeared, let us say. It is a simpler word. So for whom that disappeared, then that is that pratyagatma brahma vishayaha. That pratyagatma brahma, that is the unity of that atma with brahma, is it has resulted in that sort of negation of all bheda darshanam, negation of all this vision of duality. Then at that time, then why vastu pradhanye sati apurusha tantratvat brahma vijnanasya. So we have to see this one word called vastu tantram and purusha tantram. So here this brahma vijnanam is something, if the time is over we can explain this thing in the next class, because this vastu tantram and purusha tantram requires some little bit of explanation. I think the time is over. We'll see in the next class.
Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi.